Hello, this is John from caveofprogramming.com. In this tutorial, we're going to look at dependency injection in Spring. So in previous tutorials, I created this simple Spring program, which instantiates a person bean and just outputs that person object using a toString method and a system.out.println so that we can see what the person looks like after it's been created. So we've just got one bean defined in the XML. And what I want to show you in this tutorial is this thing called dependency injection, sometimes abbreviated to capital DI. And dependency injection is kind of a big thing in Spring, and it allows you to, if you've got an object that requires another object within it, then you can inject that second object into the first object. And rather than talk, I'll show you an example. So firstly, let's create another bean from a POJO, from a plain old Java object. So I'm going to create another class here. I'm going to right-click my package and go to New Class. I'll call this class completely arbitrarily Address because I want to give the person an address field. Click Finish. And I'll give Address a private string street and private string postcode. And I'll right click here and go to source, generate constructor from using fields. And I'll just get Eclipse to generate a basic constructor for me that sets those two fields. And finally, let's give this a toString method as well. So I'll right click and go to source, generate toString and get Eclipse to create a simple toString method for me so that we can easily look at address. Now we could already create a address bean, of course. So if I go to beans.xml, let's look at the GUI version of this XML file because it's easier to work with using the Spring IDE in Eclipse. And I'll click new bean and I'll give this an ID of address. And for the class, I'll type address and I'll click browse and then get the address class with the fully qualified package name in here and click finish. And now we should be able to, well, actually I've got to do something else first, because now if I run this program, I'll get an error. If I just run this, it's going to complain that there's no default constructor available for address, and I haven't set the fields, the address properties, in my beans.xml. So address has this constructor, but I didn't set it here in the bean. So let's do that. Let's go to beans.xml, the beans tab, and right click address and go to new constructor arg. And I'll give it a constructor arg called street with a value of, let's say number one church lane or something. Save that. And another one, let's right click address again, go to new constructor arg, insert constructor arg, sorry, and I'll give it a name of postcode and give it a value of 9876. And I don't need to add set methods here because I'm just setting the constructor, of course. So I think this should work. Let's just take a look at the raw source view of the XML, and I'll format it with Ctrl+Shift+F. And we can see we've added a couple of constructor args now that match this constructor here. So the constructor takes two arguments and we're setting both of them. So that should be all right, I think. Let's save that and run the application. And yeah, it runs fine. And just to demonstrate that we've got that bean in there, what I could do is I could say here, address equals typecast to address. And you know what I'm gonna do probably, context.getBean address. That's the ID of the address there, remember. And we could do sysout address, and if I run that, we should see the address coming out here. Well, I'm not seeing it at the moment. Let's save that and run it again. And there we go. We've got an address bean here. Now, I want person to actually have an address property. So here I want to say private address, like that. And let's modify the toString method so that the toString method also outputs address so that we'll be able to see it after we've set it. So I'll right-click my source and go to source, generate toString. So I've deleted the toString and I'm just going to regenerate it using all the fields, including address here. And address, of course, also has a toString, so this will be nicely formatted when it's output as a string. And now I need some way of being able to give an address object to a person object. So I either need to make this address a constructor argument, or I need to create a set method for address. And of course, if you're writing this without Spring, you could either create an address object here in your main program and then pass it to your person object. Or you could, for example, have extra constructor arguments in your personal object, like a street and a postcode, and create your address object within the constructor and set it that way. But what Spring allows us to do is it allows us to inject an address object into a person object. You can inject objects into each other, inject dependencies, in other words, because address here is a dependency. It's something that a person depends on in order to work. So let's, rather than have a constructor argument for address, let's have a property, let's have a set method. So I'll right click in person and go to source, generate getters and setters, and select address, select set address, and click OK. And we've got a set method there. And now what I can do is, if I go to my beans.xml, let's go to the user interface view, and I'll right click person and go to insert property element, and for the property name I'll give it address, which matches the setter. And for the this time I'm not going to supply a value. I'm going to use this ref here, and what ref is it allows you to type the ID of another existing bean that will then be injected into this bean. So here let's type address, which is the ID of my address bean, or I could have called it address 1 or address 10 or whatever I liked, you know, but I just called it address. So this is the name of the property as determined by the setter in the person class. And this is the ID of the address bean. And if you look at the source here, the address bean has an ID of address. Let's run that and see if it works. So now we've injected an address into the person, and you can see from the person's toString method that we've got a address here injected into the person. So this is the idea behind dependency injection. There are other things to say about it, but I think I'll leave those for a future tutorial. You can do stuff like, you could have a bean defined within a bean, and lots of other stuff. And it's common to code to interfaces as well, which I'm sure we'll look at in a future tutorial. I don't think, to be honest, that many people will be using Spring if dependency injection was the only good thing about Spring. Dependency injection is a thing that tends to strike you as quite cool if you've been already programming for a while. But on the other hand, you're having to learn a new framework, and your debug messages are not as straightforward. It's not as straightforward to debug a Spring program unless you have a lot of experience with Spring as it is to debug a normal program, arguably, just because you've got an extra level of complication there. So it does allow you to do stuff like change the way objects are wired together, change the dependencies you're injecting just by altering your XML, which might be an advantage if you've got a huge Java program and you want to give it different dependencies without recompiling the program. So that certainly there are many possible advantages to it, but I don't think if that was the only hook, the only pull for Spring, I don't think many people would be using it, quite honestly. And the real thing that pulls people in for Spring, I would say, is first of all that it's the biggest, Spring MVC is the biggest web framework for doing Java web applications at the moment in the world. And also there's a database support in Spring, which is pretty good. And that also persuades a lot of people to use Spring. So, and the dependency injection and wiring beans together is kind of a interesting thing that we do with Spring, but I wouldn't say it was necessarily the biggest pull myself. Okay, so that's it for this tutorial. If you're watching this on YouTube, this is probably the last video from this course that I'm going to release for free. Well, from the first bit of the course, but I'll make some more videos from the rest of the course free here and there, probably. And you can find the complete course from YouTube by clicking the link in the description. At the moment, my courses are hosted on Udemy. And if you're watching on Udemy, then you can download this source code directly there. Otherwise, if you go to my website, which is www.caveofprogramming.com, and scroll down to the YouTube videos, I'll upload the source code for this video there as well. So we're going to be going on to looking at aspect-oriented programming in the rest of the course, and the Spring MVC web framework and lots of other interesting stuff. So I do hope you'll subscribe to the complete course. So until next time, and do keep checking my website for more free tutorials, because I'll keep releasing free stuff in other Java-related subjects as well. Until next time, happy coding.